If you love a good return from retirement story, you'll probably be aware more often than not, the first act of the film consists of a supporting character urging the protagonist to return to action, generally succeeding with little to no pushback despite what seems to be a plethora of pretty damn good reasons for retirement in the first place. This is a screenplay trope that seems to span all films and genres and quite often goes glossed over and very underappreciated. But what about when a protagonist just straight up refuses? Then the film would just be over, wouldn't it?
What do you think I am? A full-blooded combat soldier.
Not anymore.
Well, not if your name is Don Logan, played by Ben Kingsley in the 2000 British film Sexy Beast. In fact, this is exactly what this film is about, and what sets it apart as a fascinating window into that moment of how persuasion through intimidation can be illustrated in moving image. The lengths that a person will go to be successful in that persuasion, the struggles it can bring, and the torment it can have. I'm Tom from Screen On Point, and this is a masterclass of intimidation and persuasion in Sexy Beast. So straight off the bat, spoilers inbound, as the film opens up with our protagonist Gary Gal Dove, a happily retired ex-convict and professional safecracker standing and admiring the view in his Spanish villa as a boulder descends from a hill and crashes past, missing him only by a few inches. He lives in Spain alongside his beloved wife Didi, best friend H and H's wife Jackie. Upon an evening out, Jackie tells Gal that she's had a phone call from Don Logan, an old and dangerous criminal associate who intends to have Gal return to London to participate in a bank vault heist masterminded by London crime lord Teddy Bass, played by Ian McShane. The mere mention of Don's name shakes the table, even more so when Jackie announces that Don will be arriving in Spain the next day to bring Gal back to London with him. It is here that we learn that Gal's relationship with Don and the jobs that he's done with him in the past has cost him 9 years of his life serving prison time.
I always dreamed of that. This, guess where? That's it. Got it right in one. Inside, that's where.
So before Don even arrives, the film sets out early indications and repercussions for this life-altering arrival with harm-inducing close calls. First, with the most obvious representation as an unexpected boulder crashes towards Gal. Secondly, with a kick of fire from the barbecue. And thirdly, with the nightmarish rabbit that haunts Gal in his dreams. But generally, the opening of the film is coated in love. The slow-motion imagery that paints Gal's life as just that, a moment to bask in, literally bask in, as Henry Mancini serenades us with his orchestra. And Don's arrival, well, that completely shatters it, bursting that bubble of bliss with fast moving tracking shots and a high octane soundtrack that displaces you, the viewer, as much as the characters on screen. In and amongst its varying themes, more than anything, this film is an extraordinary demonstration of contrasting physical behaviour between characters highlighted by the subtlety of its direction. Sexy Beast is the debut feature film from Jonathan Glazer, a visual director that grew to fame with character driven music videos such as Karma Police by Radiohead that sees Tom York takes center stage opposite a character who runs for his life, Karma Coma by Massive Attack with influences from Kubrick, and more subtle work with Nick Cave's Into My Arms with displays of different contrasting portraits. The film is undoubtedly the accumulation of thoughtful contrasting character design and imagery, not just off the back of these music videos, but the video advertisement career that Glazer led beforehand too, with adverts like Guinness's Swimback commercial that focuses on the individual. In Sexy Beast, Ray Winston's loving, out-of-shape, sun-soaked, hair-highlighted gal is in constant battle with Ben Kingsley's cold, conditioned, and well-looked-after Don. In the very first dialogue-driven scene with Don, despite being a guest in Gal's villa, he sits on the carpet at the edge of the seating area, perfectly postured, refusing comfortability in a seat elevated above the others that he most certainly chose himself, as he holds strict eye contact with each of the characters who are shrouded in darkness and trying to avoid his gaze. Though subtle, this contrast between Gal and Don is immediately set. Gal hunched in the corner of the shot, dressed in dark colours, and Don, dressed in white, ruling it, his back turned to the viewer, uninterested in catering to aesthetic. Unlike most looming arrivals in an attempt to persuade, Don sits, awaiting interaction, shutting down conversation with swift, blunt responses that don't meet his reason for visiting, dictating the pace of the conversation while doing so.
How's your brother, Don?
Malky, he's alright. I suppose he's Malky, and he dunno, you'd have to ask him.
He reiterates his dominance as the alpha male as Gao asks him if he wants a tour of the villa.
Yeah, I will in a minute when I have a piss.
In attempts to remove his loved ones from this uncomfortable situation, H stands ushering Dee Dee and Jackie to lunch, and in doing so he inadvertently creates what Don sees as conflict, as H is stood above him through a low angled shot over the shoulder of Don in a physically superior position. Don feels threatened and he counteracts this by forcing H to take his money, paying for their meal. This puts Don back on top of the pecking order, as in his world, this crime world, his money ranks him higher than H's physical positioning. By taking the money, however, H in turn is owned by Don, and Don immediately tells him to shut up.
I know.
Shut up.
And this is a key moment, because Gao adapts his behaviour to what he believes Don wants to see from him. This moment shows Don through his conditioned smile that he still has that power over Gao. So in that 1 minute and 44 second scene, the first interaction between characters as a collective, Don established himself as the dictator of pace and positioning amongst the characters, and they bend their behaviour around him, which is exactly what he wants. Immediately following this scene, as Don and Gao are stood outside the villa, Gao is asked if he is happy in Spain, to which he replies, "Very." From a long shot across the pool, Don's reaction to this without words is to pull Gao into a different area, a place where he wants the next part of this conversation to take place. He drags Gao away from being very happy, he drags Gao further away from the viewer, and he drags the viewer away from the intimate close-up shots that represents Gao's happiness that we see at the start of the film. Something that, again, Gao is conditioned to abide to, whether he knows it or not, by following him into this new area. These two subtle shots by Glazer is representative of Don's goals to steer him away from Spain and condition him back to London to do the job. At the time, despite iconic performances in Schindler's List and Bugsy, Ben Kingsley was still mostly associated with his Oscar-winning role as Gandhi in the 1982 Richard Attenborough film Gandhi. It was this Oscar-nominated role, however, as Don Logan, that finally enabled Kingsley to shed that skin. Achieving that, of course, through the blunt, piercing, and unapologetic language in Lewis Mellis and David Shinto's script, infused with a fierce physicality that side by side makes him indistinguishable from his breakout once-defining role. This amalgamation of Glazer's character direction, Mellis and Shinto's visceral script, the fast-paced edit, and of course Kingsley's predatory performance bounces viewer comfortability so swiftly that Don's arrival ends up feeling more of a wrecking ball introduction than maybe any other character that has ever done in film. This is highlighted in multiple pockets of dialogue that make Logan seem so intimidating while using the most subtle of language. Instead of simply telling Gal about the job and if he's in or not, the script builds up to it, with Don putting all the emphasis on Gal simply by asking questions. During this scene, all Don does is ask questions. In fact, he asks 11.
What did Jackie say?
Just that something was happening.
Which it is. And?
That you were planning something.
And you said?
Well, I didn't say much. I just listened.
She put a question to you.
Yeah.
Which was?
That you thought of me.
To which you said?
Well, she probably told you.
Tell me nothing.
Look, Don.
Look, Don.
It's like this.
Like what?
Retired.
Are you?
Afraid so. I'd be useless.
What, why?
In every fucking way.
Why are you swearing? I'm not swearing.
By getting Gao to answer questions, Don molds the conversation. The conversation is led by Gao, making his statements sound cooperative despite not wanting to do this job. But by getting Gao to say this out loud, Don's persuasion seems less as if it's coming from him, and even more so as if it's coming from Gao himself. A similar form of dialogue patterning can be seen in Quentin Tarantino's famous character-driven film Pulp Fiction, and specifically in the Big Kahuna Burger scene, as Jules deliberately places emphasis on Brett by asking him easy, answerable questions about his burger.
What kind of hamburgers?
Cheeseburgers.
No. Where'd you get them?
Before leading to the climax of that scene by asking him about what Marcellus Wallace looks like.
What does Marcellus Wallace look like?
This scene in Sexy Beast, like Pulp Fiction, also introduces moments that break that tone, reinforcing that above anything, that both Don and Jules are not to be messed with and to be feared.
It's over there.
I don't remember asking you a goddamn thing.
Are you swearing? I'm not swearing.
Unlike Tarantino, however, Melis and Shinto's script contains mimicking or word repetition to highlight the specifics that Don is unhappy with, forcing Gao to choose his words more wisely to words that Don wants to hear.
I'm not really up to it.
Not up to it?
No, I'm not. I'd be useless.
Useless.
Whereas mimicking can often have a positive response, a device used to indicate whether or not someone is listening, Don mimics to diminish positive perception and reinforce what he wants to hear from Gao. This is not anything new though, as a study by Louis Voss and Smeester in mimicry demonstrates that participants reminded of money, or in this case a job, resulted in the person being mimicked having a negative impression on the mimicker. The thought of money and subsequent mimicry could create a threat perception of the mimicker, something that Don absolutely wants to achieve in this scenario. He wants to persuade through the fear of violence. Following more in-depth details of the job, Don hooks Gao with fast-paced dialogue to cement Gao's involvement despite him agreeing. But after questioning Gao's body language, questions turn to statements with derogatory insults hedged in.
I'm not exactly match fit.
Seem alright to me.
No, not really, Don.
You look fine.
I'm not.
Do the job.
What?
Do the job.
No, Don.
Yes.
No.
Yes.
No.
Yes.
I can't.
You can.
I can't.
That cunt.
Don, don't do this.
Do what?
As Don gets ever so closely to getting Gao to do the job, the appearance of the pool boy breaks up the intimate close-up shots of their back and forth, and these long shots reintroduce that space between home for Gao and the job that he so desperately doesn't want to be involved in London. The boy is Gao's savior in this moment, dragging him away from the table and ultimately coming back detached from Don's space of power. Gao is able to change the pace and walk away, and for the first time shifting that power as Don chases from behind. As the film progresses, this contest between the characters and their contrasting goals are constantly illustrated in image. At the bar, Don facing outwards as Gao slumps in, and at the coaster sequence that sees Don open up to Gao, which suddenly turns violent.
Talk to me, Gao. I'm here for you. I'm a good listener.
What can I say, Don? I've said it all. I'm retired.
Shut up. Cunt, you louse. You got some fucking neck, ain't you? Retired, fuck off, you're revolting.
Is representative of the setting itself. The ocean in literature represents life and its hardships. Its symbolism changes drastically during this scene, at the start seeming calm, but within a second it rages, becoming dangerous and deadly. And of course the moment as Don peers into Gao's room at night, always lurking, as Gao is sprawled across the bed without a care in the world. These are moments that Glazer subtly uses to constantly keep the two at visual odds. Ultimately, having failed in getting Gao to come back to London with him, despite several tactics that include reminding him of Dee Dee's ex-porn career, how he's better than that, and literally shouting yes at him, Don finally leaves the villa. This, however, just sends Don into more of a psychotic spiral, highlighted in the vertigo shot of him at the airport as he becomes ever more detached from the people around him as he comes to terms with the failure of persuading Gao to return with him. This vertigo shot, along with great examples of the past, has always been used to visualize great unsettlement for characters, iconically demonstrated in the moment that Brody becomes aware of the presence of the shark in Jaws. Refusing to stub out his cigarette, an action that keeps himself from leaving Spain and in turn gives him another reason to not leave without Gao, Don finds himself held by airport security for questioning. As the investigator enters the room, Don is stood. He doesn't allow the investigator to hold a physical looming presence over him, which doesn't allow him to have the upper hand, something that we actually rarely see in interrogation scenes throughout film. And once again, Don uses a question to keep the focus off of himself.
Have you ever been sexually assaulted? No, neither have I, until today, on that plane.
What?
Yeah, that's what I said.
And as he attempts to get his way out of the situation by changing pace, for the first time, he doesn't hold eye contact. He bows his head. And where there is research from scientists from Kyoto University in Japan that suggests brains struggle in thinking of the right words while sustaining eye contact, especially in pressure moments, by dipping his head, not maintaining eye contact in this situation, it doesn't just illustrate a moment of submission for Don, but also helps accompany his premeditated lie to look more natural, to make him seem more sympathetic. In Don Logan's final scene, returning to Gao's villa, instead of calm, collected questions that we see at the start of the film, this is contrasted as Logan fires off a set of enraged rhetorical questions, once more dragging Gao into the place where he will dictate conversation. Having been mentally and now finally physically tormented, ultimately, it's both the pool boy and Dee Dee that come to Gao's rescue, proving that Gao's support system, the ones that he loves and cares for the most, can overcome an onslaught of intimidation that an individual like Don can bring. Don is the personification of anxieties come to life, the ever-worrying fear that something is around the corner to destroy our happiness. It is, in the end, every character that finishes Don off, and a nice story to show that love can overcome. There is one thing for sure though, without that support system, without that love, Don Logan would have ruled the day. Thanks for watching that video. Please do like and subscribe. We upload 2 tasty and tenderized videos a week to sink your teeth into, and do let us know your thoughts in the comments. Make sure to follow us at Screen On Point and Tom A. Ransom on Twitter to satisfy my narcissistic need for acceptance and love, and you make sure you have a wonderful day.